and I try to calculate a to the power I dot a to the power 0. Now, since we have assumed that this is also equal to a to the power n, instead of writing this, I can choose to write like this also. And in trying to calculate these two things, you cannot immediately say that they are equal because they look different. And since the ultimate calculation depends on these superfixes, which here is it is 0 and here it is n, so we have to actually make sure it better be the case that these two things are equal. Otherwise, the operation will not be well defined because it will depend on what representation of the element I am choosing. Is it a to the power 0 or a to the power n? And in that case, well definedness will go down the drain. Fortunately, that is not the case, and that we will now show that whether we choose this one or this one, the ultimate result is same. So let us see that first of all. Note that for any a to the power I in G, we have, let us first calculate a to the power I dot a to the power 0. You see, since I lies between 0 and n, and I plus 0 then also lies between 0 and n, because after all it is I. So according to this definition, this product is equal to a to the power I plus 0, just that. Which is equal to a to the power I. And you can see clearly that the same can be said from the other direction, that is a to the power 0 dot a to the power I. Now, what happens to this calculation if I use a to the power n in place of a to the power 0 and a to the power I dot a to the power n? Now, what will this become? If I is equal to 0, then I plus n is n, so we will have a to the power 0 plus n, that gives me a to the power n. But if I is greater than 0, then I plus n is greater than n, so there will be two cases here. I should write like this. So if I is equal to 0, then this will be a to the power n, which is equal to a to the power 0, or I need some more space, this is equal to a to the power I also, if I is equal to 0. But if I is greater than 0, then I plus n will be greater than n. So in that case, we will have a to the power I plus n minus n, which is again equal to a to the power I, if I is greater than 0. So we can see that whatever we do, we ultimately end up with a to the power I. So here also you see a to the power I dot a to the power 0 is a to the power I. And that, if one calculates in the other changing the order, then also we get the same thing. This is equal to a to the power n dot a to the power I. So the confusion over these two things being equal and what effect they have on the calculation is gone. That is a to the power 0 and a to the power n. You can use any one of them, you are going to ultimately end up with the same answer. So with this there is no problem. But that is only one possibility. What about the other values of I and j? For integers I comma j, satisfying this, suppose none of them is equal to either 0 or n, because that case is gone. So each one of them lies between 1 and n minus 1. For such integers, we have a to the power I is equal to a to the power j if and only if I is equal to j. Equality of two apparently different symbols is only in the case a to the power 0 equal to a to the power n. For the rest of the symbols, they are all distinct. And one way of saying that they are all distinct is this: if they are superfixes are equal, then they are equal, and conversely. Hence, so in this case, the problem that we have here, the complicacy that arises here because of two different representations of the same element, a to the power 0 and a to the power n, that is not present here at all. Hence, the binary operation dot is well defined and G is closed under it. We have already proved that G is closed under it here itself. Okay, so next we are going to prove associative law. Now this will have to be in cases. Next, we prove the associative law. So we need three elements, a to the power j and a to the power k, be three elements in G. Okay. Now, I should not make some grave mistake. Let me just have the cases with me. So let us carefully go ahead. If now one case is this, if I plus j plus k, if this sum of these three integers is less than or equal to n, it may be I, j and k may be so small that their sum ultimately is less than or equal to n, then I plus j is also less than or equal to n, and j plus k is also less than or equal to n. Why? Because these integers are non-negative. So I plus j is less than or equal to I plus j plus k, and hence it will be less than or equal to n, because this one is less than or equal to n. And now we calculate this: a to the power I dot a to the power j dot a to the power k. First of all, since I plus j is less than or equal to n, by the definition of this product, this will be simply a to the power I plus j dot a to the power k. Now I plus j plus k is again less than or equal to n. So again, by using the definition of this product, we get this. But we know that addition of integers itself is associative, so this can be written as I plus j plus k. Again, because of this inequality, this can be written as a to the power I dot a to the power j plus k. You go back to the definition of dot, you see that the sum of these two integers, one of them is I and the other is j plus k, is less than or equal to n. So their dot is just this. Again, by the similar argument, we get finally get this. So in this case, if this inequality is true, then the associative law is true. Let us now see the other cases. Okay, so this case is over. So now assume that I plus j plus k is greater than n. Now under this inequality, some further cases will arise. And the first case, of course, is the one where both these sums are again less than or equal to n, but the sum of the three integers is greater than n. If I plus j is less than or equal to n and j plus k is less than or equal to n, this is not unjustified. Sum of two of them may be less than or equal to n, but when you add a third one, it becomes greater than n. However, what happens when we have these things? Then first of all, since I plus j is less than or equal to n, the first product is simply a to the power I plus j. But now when you add I plus j and k, that is greater than n. So here we have to apply the second part of the definition. This becomes a to the power I plus j plus k minus n. Okay. And this can be written also as a to the power I plus j plus k minus n. In the superfix, we are calculating with ordinary integers, and the symbols themselves are in the group. Again, using the second part of the definition, this can be written as a to the power I dot a to the power j plus k. Why? Because sum of I and j plus k is again greater than n, and this is equal to a to the power I, since j plus k itself is less than or equal to n, we have this. So in this case also, the associative law holds. What more can we have? If I plus j, I think I have, after this I have dealt with the case I always get confused at this point. One of them is less than or equal to n, but the other is greater than n, and it may happen that j plus k is greater than n. Then keep in mind that these further assumptions are all under this bigger assumption. Then in this case what happens? First of all, because of this inequality, I simply have a to the power I plus j. Then because of this bigger inequality, this will be equal to I plus j plus k minus n. So this part of the calculation is just like this one. But then the thing changes. Okay, now you looking at these calculations, you will see, I mean, you almost can't help but have a smile on your face, because the things ultimately fall in place so nicely. You see, instead of writing like this, I plus j plus k minus n, we are going to write like this, I plus j plus k minus n. Okay. Now, what about I plus j plus k minus n? That may be a question. Because here what we are doing, now we want to see what I plus j plus k minus n is, whether it is greater than n or whether it is less than or equal to n. And to see that, I think I should have done the calculation here itself. Anyway, let me do the calculation here. You see, I plus j is less than or equal to n. So I plus j plus k minus n will be less than or equal to k. What we have done is we have added k minus n on both sides. And what about k? K itself is less than or equal to n. So the sum of these two integers, I and j plus k minus n, is actually less than or equal to n. But there is one more thing that we should think of. What about j plus k minus n? Is it a non-negative integer? That will come from this inequality. You see, since j plus k is greater than n, it implies j plus k minus n is greater than 0. So j plus k minus n is actually a positive integer. But can it be greater than n? No, it cannot be greater than n, because you see, I think instead of writing this as rough words, I should probably put them into words. That will be, or let us just rub this thing off, and since we now know what we have to do, so we can be prepared before we write the calculation. Then I plus j plus k minus n is less than or equal to k, which is less than or equal to n, and j plus k minus n is greater than 0. Since j and k are both less than or equal to n, you see here, j is less than or equal to n and k is less than or equal to n. So if you add them, you will get j plus k less than or equal to 2n. That implies j plus k minus n is less than or equal to n. So this is less than or equal to n. And so now we can do the calculation. First of all, this part will be just like this one, a to the power I plus j, because I plus j is less than or equal to n, and I plus j plus k is greater than n, so I plus j plus k minus n. Then after that we write the superfix like this. And now because of these above inequalities, what I am doing is I am going to write it like this. A to the power I dot a to the power j plus k minus n. The question is whether this makes sense. You see, a to the power j plus k minus n is again an element in G because of these inequalities. J plus k minus n is an integer lying between 0 and n. So this is again an element in G. A to the power I is already an element in G. What about the sum of these two integers? The sum of these two integers, one of them is I and the other is j plus k minus n, is less than or equal to n. So according to the definition of our product, this is simply equal to this. Okay, now this step is justified and this becomes equal. Okay, I need ink. Give me a moment. But since j plus k minus n itself is, since j plus k is greater than n, so this part is equal to, it takes some time to come, or it's better I write here. Since j plus k is greater than n, this part again by the second part of the definition of dot is equal to a to the power j dot a to the power k. So in this case also the associative law is true. Then there is one more case. If I plus j is greater than n and j plus k is also greater than n, then what happens? Okay, let us first go through the calculation, then we will know what we need along the way and we can then have space to calculate those things. Okay, so here I plus j is greater than n, so according to our definition, this will be a to the power I plus j minus n dot a to the power k. Okay. Now, what happens to the sum of these two? I plus j minus n plus k. Let us see. I plus j minus n is positive, okay, plus k is greater than k. So what does that mean? This implies I plus j minus n plus k is greater than k. It only tells us that it is greater than k and hence it is greater than 0. But what about it being less than n or less than or equal to n or greater than n? I think further cases arise here. Yes, it depends. It depends on two things. So we cannot start with if. Let I plus j and j plus k both be greater than n. If I plus j minus n plus k is less than or equal to n, then we will have one calculation. And this becomes equal to I plus j minus n, just like before. And now since we know that this is less than or equal to n, it will be minus n plus k. Okay, now what about this I plus j plus k minus n? Still this sum is less than or equal to n, so we can write a to the power I dot a to the power j plus k minus n. Note that j plus k minus n is positive, so this symbol actually is again in G, and that is equal to, and also keep in mind that can we have j plus k minus n greater than n, because then this symbol will not be in G. That problem is still there. For this to happen though, j plus k has to be greater than or equal to 2n. Since the maximum values of j and k can be n, so this will happen only when j is equal to n and k is equal to n. Oh. But when j and k are n, then can we carry out the calculations separately? That's what I'm thinking. Even further cases are needed. This is getting so messy. Okay, so if we have j and k both equal to n, okay, then we can replace them by 0. Why? Because a to the power n is equal to a to the power 0. And in that case, we ultimately fall back to the case where I plus j is less than n, or I plus j is less than or equal to n, and j plus k is also less than or equal to n. But that is not the case here. You see, I plus j is greater than n and j plus k is greater than n. So that's why that case will not arise. So this becomes equal to, now we have a to the power I. Okay, now since j plus k is greater than n, this becomes equal to this. Okay, now there is actually, strictly speaking, there is one more case where I plus j is greater than n and j plus k is less than or equal to n. But because the operation is commutative, if you see, if you look at the operation closely, you will see that a to the power I dot a to the power j is equal to this. So from what we have already proved, that case has been covered. In fact, we should write like this. It goes like this. Finally, the case where we have I plus j is greater than n and j plus k is less than or equal to n, with this of course that is there, that inequality is always there in whatever we are doing at in this part, is or follows from what we have proved above. Because the operation dot is commutative. Although we did not mention it formally, but one can very easily see that the operation is commutative. So how exactly are we dealing with this case? You see, if we want to calculate this, now because of commutativity, we can change the order in whatever way we want. So this becomes equal to what? A to the power k dot a to the power I dot a to the power j. Okay. And if you want to further use commutativity once more, you get this. So now you see j plus k is less than or equal to n and I plus j is greater than n. So the way we have been able to write this product, it is just this case where the sum of the first two exponents is less than or equal to n, k plus j is less than or equal to n, and the sum of the second and last exponent is greater than n. J plus k is greater than n. Here j plus I is greater than n. So we ultimately come back to this case. So this proves that the operation is associative. It takes a lot of effort, but only because there are many cases. Dot is associative. We have already seen that a to the power I dot a to the power 0 is equal to a to the power I, which is also equal to a to the power I dot a to the power, a to the power 0 dot a to the power I. For all a to the power I in G. Hence, a to the power 0, actually it's also equal to a to the power n, but that need not be mentioned here. We only keep in mind, we only need one identity element. Hence, acts as an identity. for any a to the power I in G, one can verify that a to the power n minus I, which is also again in G, this also is easy to see why, acts as an inverse of a to the power I. So that's it. All the four axioms have been verified, and also the operation has been found to be commutative. I leave it to you to see that the operation is actually, it's very easy. You just go to the definition and see that a to the power I times a to the power j actually equals a to the power j times a to the power I. So this is not only a group, but it is an abelian group, that too finite, having n elements. So G is an abelian group of order n, and it has a name, as you already know probably. It is called